thanks for inviting me to Python. To be honest, I'm not doing lots of public talks, so it's going to be slightly
hesitated in progress, but yeah.
Anyways, my name is Alexander Sabin. I'm a web developer at a company called Bitpacha. I'm also a Skyler. Oh. This is Finland, it's not UK, but I do Skyler in the UK as well. Still talking to the summit. So I work for a company called Bitpacha, and we host React London Meetup. We started last year. Started as a really small thing at our office near Old Street, and then at some point towards the end of last year, we noticed that people do not fit in the office, and people are standing on steps and everywhere. This is where Facebook came in and just said, "Okay, we'll help you out." So we, at the moment, we have over 2,000 members on meetup.com, and we host meetups once every 2 months. And this guy over there is Nick Schrock. He is one of the creators of GraphQL. This is where he explains how you can start using GraphQL today if you're stuck in the middle of a huge project where nobody knows what it is. You'll get there. It's like a small spot. So the topic is actually, the topic of this meetup was announced practical GraphQL, but actually we're going to talk about GraphQL, but also like Relay, React, Node, and even a little bit about React Native. So the whole thing is going to be, in a way, conversational. And also, you are using GraphQL every single day, and like today morning I was actually implementing like extension for GraphQL and on our current project, and in the evening I'm talking GraphQL to you. So this is stuff we're actually using. We are using it every day on our quite large project. And I think this is where I'm jumping to real life story. Generally, technologies, I mean, there are so many things, technological things happening every day, and sometimes really hard to tie them quite quickly. You know, what kind of situation we would ever meet something like that. So this is the situation. Front-end application projects. You develop a front-end application, and as a front-end application, you are tasked with consuming different services. RESTful services. Anyway, service A. So, as many of you know, REST is an interesting thing. I mean, there is a specification, but in many years of web development, I still hope to see someone who actually understands it the same way as I did. Every single web developer understands it differently. And the project we are working at, it's supposed to consume different services. And here's Service A. Service A is developed by a remote team in a different country. It's been developed for quite a while in disconnection from our application. Our application, in fact, the first client application is going to consume Service A. Service A is an interesting service. They decided they understood REST slightly differently than we do. There's also Service B. Service B is even more interesting because those guys, again, different team, different location, slow issues with communications. These guys decided to drive the UI. They send you almost like DOM elements in RESTful responses, and they want you to render those. Service A actually tells us that Service B is crazy. Don't listen to them. But we are already in a situation that we have to move on. There's also Service C, which is available, and it's mostly fine, but it's available in different Wi-Fi network. We are talking about a large company. There's like 2 corporate Wi-Fi networks in the company. When you connect to first network, you can consume Service A and Service B, but not Service C. To consume Service C, you need to connect to different Wi-Fi network. But then obviously you cannot consume Service A and Service B. And there's Service D, which is even not implemented yet, but you're already supposed to consume it because of like UI features you must deliver to the user eventually. So, yeah. So, keep this keep this story in mind. We'll do now like a detour into the world of GraphQL, and we found ourselves in a situation when GraphQL will kind of solve our issues. Issue might think about graph issues, okay. But so but keep this in mind. We'll now go into GraphQL and we'll come back to the Facebook. So GraphQL is by Facebook. Facebook made a specification of language. And Facebook traditionally been a quite huge monolithic web application. They have like a website. Still are. I mean, mainly Facebook is a website. Huge. There's lots of things going on in there. And at some point, they decided to make a native application for iPhone. And this was the moment when Facebook, for the very first time in the life of Facebook, they had an extra client, which wasn't the web page, wasn't the front end of the web page, but was actually some other application that was supposed to consume data from backend. And backend at that point was only providing data for one single client, nobody else. So the original native application was quite simple, and people complained about, I want to do more stuff, I want feature parity. So then they were like, okay, let's give you feature parity. And then they did like a wrapper around web application on the native client for Android and iOS, I believe. And then people started complaining about performance issues because in 2011, web applications on an iPhone wasn't really shiny. So, and then Facebook said, okay, let's do everything right. Let's do fully native application. Let's do it properly and let's provide feature parity. And this is when they started thinking about how they need to shift things, because backend at that point, again, still wasn't really ready for multiple clients. So thinking about it, it's really hard. They came up with the idea of GraphQL. Yeah. So, one of the common misconceptions about GraphQL, like, oh, there's a graph in this name, there's probably a graph database behind it. There's no graph database behind it, in matter of fact, you can use any sort of database. You can use the various things. So, what is GraphQL? What do you need to start working with that? You need a GraphQL server, and you need a GraphQL client. And, well, GraphQL client will ask server stuff, and then several video stuff back to the client. So client will create effectively a GraphQL query string, send it to server, and then server will process the GraphQL query string and send a JSON response. This is important because this is like, you send a string which is effectively a GraphQL query string, and you get the pure data in response. I mean, you would assume that you would get like a response like query, and respond the same language. I think they just cut that con there because you would have to convert in data anyway, so you just get JSON afterwards. So effectively GraphQL is a language for read and write actions. And really like the basics of the GraphQL. So queries. This is basically hello world in GraphQL. So it looks a lot like JSON, it's not JSON, but it looks a lot like the current process, and you pick this like a user, my name. If you send it to a GraphQL server, you would receive something like this. Like that's GraphQL, this is JSON. Notice how symmetrical this is. So the shape is exactly the same. You refer to the certain shape, and you get the response in exactly the same shape. Mutations. So, as I just said, it's not just querying the data, you also want to mutate the data. So, this is how a mutation would look like. You would use a word mutation, you would name it, and then you create, let's create user. And then you would provide some arguments for the mutation. And in addition to that, what you also do, you also request something in return. So you basically tell your server, this is what I want from you to do. And when you're done, let me know these things. query arguments are effectively this. So you want to provide some arguments with queries, and what users usually have IDs. So in this case, you can do nesting. So users have friends. So in this case, again, give me user with a city and give me his name, perhaps. And also give me a list of friends and list names of friends. But also, friends can have friends, and friends can have friends. You can do like this, like, as much as you want. Composition. Like, here we have a couple of different fields. Sometimes the query becomes pretty long. So you want to do something like fragments. So you would define fragments on the type of user. You list all the fields you are interested in. Then you use spread operator in GraphQL and you just inject this fragment into the query. Quite often, when you implement an application which requests creates GraphQL queries, fragment will be a view of your application, one particular view. So you would create different fragments, one fragment per view, and then you would kind of inject those into queries.
But when you add the fragment, when you add the fragment to the client, presumably.
Yeah, so this is all on the client.
Yeah.
And this is also on the client. So this is a thing you create and then just send to the server.
And so when do you write the or when does the client get to hear about the fragment?
Yeah. Is it like part of the query itself?
Yeah.
Yeah, so so effectively you define your fragment on the client and then you when you compose your query, you would sort of use your fragment, or fragments, effectively.
So it's kind of like a variable, yeah. I guess.
Or a with statement, that's your...
Yeah, something.
Right. That's the query on the left.
Yeah, that's...
Spread operator and putting in the
this one.
Yeah. No, the whole thing's a query, that's what I understand. Yeah.
So the dot represents it as a fragment?
Yeah, so you just kind of destructuring the fragment into the query.
But
this is still GraphQL, not JavaScript.
Yeah. GraphQL.
Type system. This is now we move to server. So you define types on server. So what kind of things you might want to provide for clients to consume. This is probably the simplest type in the client. So type user, which can have a name, type string, ID, string, exclamation mark. Exclamation mark basically means that you must provide ID. And yeah, fine. And probably one of the last things, yeah, that's before we actually go into live coding part of the presentation, there will be a few of those. This is probably the last thing you need from server. You define like a root query, and then you define, you list basically all the types you support from server.
There you go. Semantics of having an exclamation mark required.
String!
Very rude. They use exclamation marks in all.
Yeah, they have exclamation marks meaning mutation.
Yeah.
It means Swift, it means unpack option. Unpack option.
Ah.
So, yeah, you're saying, I know that there's a thing here.
Well, one quick question then, with the type, the fundamental type shows string in the example there, is it just the fundamental base types, or can you define your own types to declare?
So, you define your own types based on fundamental types. So, basic types which are supported by GraphQL itself. And then you define your kind of structure, so to say, based on top of that. And this is what we are going to do right now.
Okay. So
I'm going to use this service called reindex.io. It's GraphQL backend for your React applications. And we're not going to code React right now. We're only going to do some schema. So bear with me.
Thanks.
So re-index is a bit like parse. You sort of create your own database.
It's like a GraphQL backend. So that's effectively a GraphQL server for you.
Yeah.
So what you do, you define your schema. So this is quite the quite.
But it's sort of backend as a service backend.
Yes. Yeah. Exactly. Yes.
So it's just quick. Do you mind sort of dragging it more up towards the top of the screen so people in the back can see it? Okay. Right. Can you guys see it?
Awesome. So this is effectively our really simple schema which we have. So we have a user, which is an object. There's also this thing called interface, which is not. This basically just means that we will implement an ID of a user ID, just promising the system that we will implement ID, promising. And it's going to be unique and it's going to be not known. But I mean, if we define a user, it's probably would be nice to have something else in addition to ID, so let's do something like
this JSON format, is this?
This is actually GraphQL.
Okay.
Oh wait, actually, yeah, right, sorry. This is JSON. This is JSON which we are going to push to the server and then things become really interesting.
Is this GraphQL stuff or is this re-index stuff?
So this is we are basically defining a schema for re-index. So able to provide us backend services.
And this is the GraphQL schema you could give to any GraphQL server?
Yes. Well, I mean, the way you define it generally would be slightly different. So now we're using just pure JSON to define the schema. But personally, so now things will become really interesting.
I think you did GraphQL?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. There you go.
GraphQL is like a demo that you can download from various GitHub repos, which gives you like a live see how it is. You can type your stuff in live.
So this is effectively our backend, GraphQL backend, and you can start doing some stuff. So we can do a query, let's say these reserves. And so it's like a keyboard combination, context space, and then you get all this useful stuff. Again, I'm jumping a little bit leaping kind of forward because re-index actually provides me with a better stuff. But imagine, for example, that you're a developer, you're developing against the existing backend about which you have no idea or documentation, nothing. So this is the situation you find yourself quite often when you develop against RESTful APIs. Documentation usually exists, but quite often it's awful or really complicated, and you end up poking things with Postman and like, you also need some sort of authentications and stuff. So this is actually me exploring what can I do. So for example, I can do this like a view, and also notice this. This is a description of what this thing actually is, again provided by a server. So the global numbers fields used to vary all the objects by the type, as well as currently signing feature. Let's see this one. It sounds useful. What else can I do? I can do all users. And I can, for example, count all of them, or I can do list of edges with the connection. So I can do node, and now I can actually list what first name of the user. Don't have much there in there, but Well, I haven't really typed much. I just was just using that ahead. Now I have a full-fledged query, so I can run it, get some response. Not with your null field user first name. Yeah, the thing is, I mean, we can't really create any of those. So let's create. For creating, we need to create the mutation, so it's mutation. And what can we do? We can create a user. And this is where you need to provide actually some data to create a user. So you will do something like credentials, first name, yes, first name. And at this point, it will actually tell us that you must also request something from the server. It's not just created. This is kind of the point of GraphQL as well. So because mutations are also queries, so you must request something in return. So what can we request? We can request ID, and we can request... Oh, actually, that's a changed user. That sounds good. So let's do it. Let's do changed user. And we can have ID and first name. So we're going to create a user, and then once server is down, we're going to ask the server, and also please return us this user.
It's missing a comma after ID.
Ah, that's the thing. This is GraphQL, it's not JSON. You can do this. So there you go. So we have created the user, and there's a unique ID and the first name.
So the ID that it returned, instead of change user, you could have also selected ID. Is that a different ID?
Oh, that's trans.
Yeah, can you request all of the fields?
Yes, you can. This is. I really like this audience. You know what you're talking about. This is another fun thing about this. So we have a user, but what we can also do, we can do. So we need to get it. Server, please give us all the types that you support and just list us, for example, all the fields.
So is that double underscore schema actually part of the specification? As in, or is that something magic for?
This is part of the specification. This is part of the specification that's called introspection.
And which is happening in the content, so.
So if we run this one, you get all sort of stuff. So this all sort of stuff actually comes by Reindex. Reindex is smart enough to create all this, most of the stuff kind of for you once you purchase the initial schema. But again, let's imagine that we are front-end developers and we're developing against existing backends. Really useful. So you can kind of just see, what else can you find? There's the commissions, URL name. So, query type, mutation type, that's in general. So yeah, let's cover it up. So, if you've never seen GraphQL before, you should be like, how this thing works? And again, introspection is the answer. Because you can request from a server, dear server, tell me everything you know, and everything I can do with you, and server will do. Yeah, there you go. And this is exactly what GraphQL does. It requests, through the introspection aspect of GraphQL, it requests everything it can do. This is how it provides you type ahead. This is how it provides us the validations. As you type your query, it can tell you, by the way, the type of your value you inputted is wrong. It should be something else that you type. And also you forgot this and this. Introspection allows you to build tools for the basically backend. And GraphQL is basically one of the tools. And GraphQL is also probably the easiest way of selling idea of GraphQL to probably anyone. If you ever used Postman for exploring RESTful APIs, you know how sometimes it can be awful. It takes a lot of time. You have to guess lots of things. You have to read documents which are sometimes really vague or just missing. And it's just poking RESTful services is so unrewarding. It can be really awful. So, yeah, I kind of already covered all, most of the stuff. So, yeah, like schema types, fields.
Is there such a thing like a star? Is there such a thing like a star instead of putting listing the fields out? Is there a way of saying show me all of us?
But I mean effectively it's just like you specify the shape again of the data you want in return and it returns you data. You know, speaking stuff. So there you go, shape part. This is, I mean, again, when you implement RESTful interfaces, you know that quite often the data is provided in a way you have to convert it into other thing. My colleague, who's shown programmers, he usually calls it that data massaging. You have to massage the data into some other shape from the data shape you get. With GraphQL, you get everything in exact shape you requested. So when you develop an application, you develop a new feature, and you develop UI for this feature, you know exactly what data you need, and you request only that data in the shape you are ready to consume. And a GraphQL server returns you exactly the same shape you want. It's nothing more, nothing less. No overfetching. Overfetching can be quite critical. Again, with RESTful interfaces, quite often you get a bunch of stuff you don't need. So you just do start picking out fields. I need this one and this one is the rest I actually don't need. But the fact is that your client might be on a mobile phone somewhere on 2G in the forest somewhere. And you just sent him a bunch of data he didn't actually need it but already paid for it.
So in that case, with the lower fetching, I love the idea that you shared the data yourself. But earlier, even with updates, you said you have to request something back, you have to get a query result.
Mm-hmm.
Is that not contradicting the overfetching? All I want to do is say, add one to that value, I then have to sell, but at least give me the ID back of the value of the record that's been updated, as opposed to, I'm not interested in it, I'll just add one and I don't care. You're fetching something, you have to supply at least one thing with a query to come back.
I never tried the question. Quite possibly you could try it actually. The idea that no overfetching seems that's an
omission.
I think generally you're interested in knowing did your data actually change?
Update it all
about the system. Tell the user, yeah, everything's fine, and like, I don't know, update your stream of views or something. So, and again, you might just request like some boolean, like true or false, or something like that.
I just think, say something like location data, just keep sending GPS coordinates. Sometimes they'll be there, sometimes they won't. You don't always want something back virtually the same size as the data you're sending. You're just passively.
I think this is going to be a slightly interesting topic because, like, at the moment you can do queries and mutations, but in the future they're also going to introduce something called subscriptions as well.
Yeah.
So this is streaming of the data. I think it's kind of coming at some point. I'm not sure what that means. So, yeah, this is also really important because you want to make as little HTTP requests as possible, especially on mobile phones, especially like somewhere where coverage is quite bad. So you do a single request from a client to your application, and then your application, again, potentially you are dependent on someone else's services, so your application can sort of accumulate this in a single place and then do extra requests for you, and then again, assemble the response, JSON response, and send it to you in one way. So you single request, single response, So this is again a little bit of deeper interest. And so this was one guy who wrote a blog post how they were migrating from RESTful interface towards a GraphQL. And this is, I think it's a good example how with time your RESTful responses and interfaces evolve. So because they were having a case when they had like more and more clients consuming the same endpoints, they had to grow responses to cater for different clients. This is quite often how things become RESTful. GraphQL is a certification. It's not. So Facebook released a specification of the language, and then they also released the reference implementation in JavaScript, and they also released the middleware for Node applications, so you can just plug in this thing in your application and get things working. But it's effectively just a specification. It doesn't even specify the transport you must use, so you can use any transport you want. There are already implementations in languages like Ruby, .NET, Scala, and a bunch of others. And this is where I'm going to demonstrate you how you plug GraphQL into your Express application. So again, the query, this is actually a nice thing about GraphQL, it also preserves your query in the URL, so you can keep on going and stop in there. So, yeah, it's okay. And yeah, again, you get full type of kind of stuff. So, effectively, yeah, this is your application, this GraphQL and GraphQL.
So, can we just have a look at how that text.json ties in with
it? Yeah, what is it actually storing? What's it doing with the data? How do you tie this interface into something like that?
It's in the resolve method that I saw.
Yes. So, this actually good point. There you go. So, resolve is effectively, so schema is where we're getting query, and get data. These are type and arguments, which is going to give me an ID of the type string. Mm-hmm. Resolve method is, this is really important part of the whole GraphQL implementation. You must provide resolve methods, and this is where you do all sort of logic to actually do whatever you need to fetch, create a response that you've been requesting. In this case, it's just data arguments by me. But basically, this is where you will do request multiple RESTful endpoints, potentially combine them in a single response, do some sort of data manipulation. So GraphQL by itself does not take the pain of adapting data from RESTful endpoints. You still have to do it yourself. But it allows you to do this in a single place. So generally, logic of kind of massaging the data from RESTful endpoints is kind of creeps out. It goes all over the application. In this case, it's always inside resolve method.
And for asynchronous, I mean, making a request to multiple, that looks very asynchronous.
This is going to be actually, I think it's going to be one of the next slides. So these are effectively endpoints you want to request. And this is asynchronous resolve. And you can do asynchronous resolve. You can use async awaits in your server side, GraphQL server implementation. So you can do asynchronous resolve. And GraphQL will be completely fine with that. It will be like, oh, okay, it's asynchronous, so I'll just do stuff and wait for it, and then it will provide you a response once. So this is where we do kind of processing endpoints. Again, we are doing this asynchronously, and some promises services. And yeah, this is where we actually kind of processing endpoints and getting stuff on the way. Yeah, preparing stuff, doing stuff, and then if there are any errors in the response, then put them into errors, and if there are any errors, then throw. And if everything is still fine, then we return an object, so it's like access stuff in the fresh pattern, which is, so in this case, we can assign a user into the application. So if everything is fine, no errors, we throw access stuff in the fresh pattern for the end user, which indicates that everything is fine. So this is our JSON response for the GraphQL request. Synchronous.
So before you move on, perhaps it's, no, the line at the bottom, there we are, yeah, there it is. That's unusual ESX for me. Is that a list comprehension?
So which one?
Const processes equals an array with a for loop inside at the top of the screen.
Oh yeah. This is, I believe, is syntax.
What is it?
Array comprehension.
It's definitely got pushed back.
It's like a weird syntax for a
loop. Yeah,
it's like a bit like map. It's got removed from Babel.
Okay.
That means it's dead.
If we're using Babel with stage 0, so we get all the stuff.
You're using what term?
Babel is stage zero, so we get. We haven't moved to Babel 6. So.
I think we might have actually removed that. It's fine, you might go and plug in now.
Again. Yeah. Relay. So Relay is an application framework that builds on top of the ideas of GraphQL. Helps you in many different ways. I think what I'm going to do now, I'm going to again like deep dive into our test application we did. So when Relay came out in August, me and my colleague, we spent 2 weeks just kind of hacking on a simple block engine on top of Relay and GraphQL. And I'm going to show you what we achieved. But I'm not going to dive too deep into Relay because, first of all, I haven't really done much of Relay after that. And second of all, it's such a huge topic because it can do so much for you. And it's not that simple to start with. But the power of Relay, I want to demonstrate. This is going to be an application. Just going to put this one. Start this one. So this is application hit, again with React components. And this is component called post. This component is used for displaying the block post. This is effectively like a really simple block engine application, I think. So this component displays you a particular post, a page with a particular post. And again, JSX. And this is where things become really interesting. This is where you define what kind of data your component would like to consume. So you have a title of the post, body of the post, some likes, experiment stuff. And we are using them, so we have a post title, so I'm going to just show you how to actually do this. So when I open the particular post, this is effectively our component. So what if we want to make a new feature and add an author's first name and last name and a link to a user profile in here? We're going to do it. It's going to be interesting.
So we reduce the font size a little bit, so we can have a bit more context.
Sorry.
No, I'm just thinking
about that. So, what we need to do, effectively, we need to... So we're going to basically adjust this data requirement and we just going to tell. There you go. So now...
Just got an extra.
So now we can request the data for this particular component. And in addition to that, we need to actually append it. So we're going to...
So that's a client template string.
Well, this is just GraphQL, right? So this is just like a fragment on post, and then we have like...
Yeah, but we have GraphQL and then React.
Yeah, and then we're going to drop this piece of UI. This and the page. now we have personal last name.
Right.
So, what Relay is doing for us in the background, it figures out what kind of data our application, in this particular case, our component wants, and Relay creates a final query to the GraphQL server for us, and just provides us the data. They mentioned they're going to release a special version of, well, probably the next version of the React tables will support Relay as well. At the moment, it's slightly daunting because you need to dig into the post requests of your application inside the Chrome DevTools, so you need to actually expand everything, see what's going on in there. Which is also pretty interesting because Relay is doing quite a lot of stuff behind the scenes. It helps you with optimistic updates, it kind of prevents you from overfetching, it kind of caches stuff for you. So in a nutshell, kind of Relay is smart enough to figure out what kind of data you actually need to request from server and what kind of data you already requested. You probably haven't updated yet, so it kind of gives you it right away. Does lots of stuff. Again, Relay is optional, you don't have to use it, and it's still under heavy development. Maybe not that heavy, but they're going to bring more stuff in the future. And at the moment, Relay is client side only. It's not universal. This is the reason we are not using it currently for our projects.
So, did you say that it keeps track of what data you've already requested and how long ago it was that you requested it?
Something like that.
So,
I'm not super familiar with this exact mechanics how it does, but it definitely when we were the block engine I was showing, when you request an index page with blog posts, and for example if you request titles of the blog posts and then a body, and if assuming that the body is full, so once you go to the page of one particular post, it will only request the data you haven't already requested from the index page. And you can see from if you go into DevTools, you can actually make sure that does not request extra stuff. And it does it for you, you don't have to do anything. Well, you actually have to do quite a lot to start with the initial setup. And this is why my colleague later on wrote the blog post titled Give It 5 days instead of Give It 5 minutes. But yeah. Using components. So again, this is the thing related to Relay. Using components. These components are a really awesome idea. What if we can create components and use them everywhere in different applications? Really hard to achieve. So here's an idea about self-contained components. So what if we want to create a component that is easy to get out of the application and potentially use somewhere else? This is a structure actually we're using at the moment on many projects. So you would have a folder with your component. I'm talking about graph components. And you would have logic, you would have styles, you would have also tests and test your component. But then, again, you need to provide a way of data, how to request the data, and this is where Relay comes in. Yeah. Optimistic updates. Optimistic updates generally is really hard to implement, and Relay helps you with that, because Relay It has whole application is contained within a central state object within the Relay, and Relay creates a separate mutation object when you want to mutate something, and it mutates UI. Well, UI kind of as a consequence of that changes right away when you want to do some stuff. Then Relay dispatches a request to the server, and if the response is different or unsuccessful, it kind of it discards a temporary mutation and just reverts to state that the whole application was before that, and you are kind of just a defacto. Or it keeps the mutation and just merges it into the something state. And, error handling kind of tied to optimistic updates. And optimal data fetching. I'll talk a little bit longer. What is also what's also coming to Relay is offline mode and flaky networks. Mostly flaky networks support and probably less offline, but still they're going to implement something like that within the Relay itself, which I mean pretty interesting.
When you say flaky networks, you mean mobile?
Yes, exactly. Well, even you want to try and you get a network and then you request some data, then you lost the network and you lose the network. So because Relay is from the client only at the moment and preserves all data kind of locally, when you change state of the application, it creates, again, like it creates like a communication object.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't have a network at this moment, I presume it will kind of just kind of wait for it. But object is already there. So again, like for example, when you create a mutation object, it sends to the server, something horrible happens in the middle. Right now, you have an option to present the user like some sort of UI like failed, wanna try again. And when you press try again, you already have this mutation object already created. So you have to redo all the stuff. You just basically just in trying that was already in kind of prepared.
And does that connection object get persisted? So if I'm on train and I try and post something, it fails and transparently in the background tries again whenever.
Mm.
How long will it retry for, and what kind of things will it persist over?
I don't think it's going to retry automatically for you. I think it's just something again you have to implement, but it will help you in a way that it has a state object for you. But the actual logic, I think, of retrying is something you have to kind of present to the user potential or just do something. Yeah, Relay is like the whole setup phase is actually quite large. Defining mutations is like a completely separate huge topic. The mutations, when you describe it for Relay, they must describe every single kind of field that might potentially be affected by mutations.
Can it be auto-generated?
Not really. But then again, it kind of makes you think about implementing your web application well, because quite often when we implement web applications, we try to either be in denial or not think about horrible, not horrible, but hard things that they implement. Like optimistic updates are notoriously a good example. You should be doing this, but quite often it's pretty hard. And Relay, if you go Relay rate, it will force you to think about it, because unless you prepare all the stuff, the whole application will not work, so you must care about those things.
Yeah, you're saying that you're defining the mutations in Relay now, which is client side. Are you having to do this twice? So you've got to set up what your mutations are on the GraphQL server side,
yeah,
and then you've got to do it again?
I think the way you define mutations on Relay is quite as
different. Yeah, I mean, I can see why, because you're talking about like what it wants to know what's changed, so it needs its own version of the schema, but can it not like pull half of it down?
I think when we're talking about Relay, it's mostly our kind of local state of the application. So things like, so Relay effectively replaces Flux in a way. So they're like
these the action stores.
But then again, it's a moment, like right now, Relay only handles data which been remotely fetched. So at the moment, Facebook, for example, they're using Relay in combination with Flux, and you could use something else as well. But then again, Relay is going to support local state as well. So some data which you only have locally and haven't already fetched, not yet. So yeah. So this is Facebook's Ads Manager application, and it's written down in React Native. And there you go. You can use for the light, use React Native. And this is where things become again really interesting. React Native is famously not code once, use everywhere. It's learn once, use everywhere. So as of today, you have React Native for iOS and Android. So you can create React applications for iOS and Android. But also, you can use Relay with iOS and Android native applications. And this is where you can reuse code between iOS and Android native applications. Not everything, but logic that actually handles data fetching, data handling, and basically everything related to Relay and Relay. So this allows you code reusability across iOS and Android. And in this particular case, Nick Schrock, when he was presenting this, he said that they were able to reuse 87%
Jeez.
In this particular application case. This is like, So again, like UI is, when you implement a native application, it's really important to use native UI components. And this is where you will implement native UI using native UI components. But then there's a logic for the data handling. Can be reused. Okay, once again. 87%. Also, like GraphQL is a block, and but generally speaking, React was a technology, is a technology that you can start really small. You can use React in your Angular application or your Ruby on Rails application or like any pretty much application. It's a tiny little thing. You can like start with one component and just grow and grow. Eventually, it will take over the world. But so GraphQL is again, it's like a block of technology which fits nicely with rest of the blocks. And all of those blocks are pretty much optional, except probably for Relay and React. Relay is kind of tied to React at the moment. I think they're planning to do more suppression about that. But again, like you can use React with nothing else. You can use, well, Flux is kind of a pattern that is mostly meant for React applications. In GraphQL, you can use GraphQL again with pretty much anything. You don't have to use GraphQL to get React applications, as long as your application can construct queries in GraphQL language, and as long as your GraphQL server can understand those queries and parse them into whatever your language is. And then again, database behind that server can be again, anything, because you are the one responsible for maintaining implementing backend, so yeah. Vector, sorry. Again, front-end application, bunch of services. Each service implemented in a different way, and not really kind of friendly services to consume. So what we are doing at the moment, something like this. We have a GraphQL server, which is at the moment, we are using Express middleware, so we basically just plug it into our application. We are going to separate it in a separate, complete separate thing. So potentially, it could be potentially something like this. With multiple clients consuming the same GraphQL endpoints, which would talk to each of those services. Final thing is also because some of those services, as I mentioned, they are sort of on their own, in their own universe, on their own Wi-Fi networks and stuff like that. So you want to mock all of them ideally. And mocking of those services become really easy when you have GraphQL server, because all you need to do is just mock responses, JSON responses. There you go. You can develop and train. Also, you can have versions of the application and first version application, and all of those versions can talk to the same GraphQL endpoint. GraphQL endpoint presents you with the possibilities of the queries you can request. It's not like, it's not saying like this is the only thing you can have, and that's it. And if you want something more, you must speak to the member of our team, and in 6 months we'll build a new endpoint. So GraphQL server expresses you like a list of possibilities, and then each of the clients can consume it in various different ways. Obviously, the types, like you want to define new types for new pages eventually and like grow those things as you go. But even when you grow, you don't have to grow your responses. You still only get the data you want. And if you want to duplicate something, this is again nice detail about GraphQL, you can put a duplicated field on your field, and it will stop it from showing up in type ahead in GraphQL. But you will still be able to consume it, so it will just keep them for new clients. And yeah, so it's like nice, graceful duplication of stuff. Facebook guys, they keep saying that they haven't really, they're still supporting, they're just growing their list of types to support. But yeah. Eventually, in an ideal world, or if you're starting with a new application, this is probably the picture you have. You won't have RESTful services, again, ideally in the future, somewhere open. And probably you'll only have like one block in the beginning, which will talk to the GraphQL server and no RESTful services. This is the original blog with the same developer he wrote on a GraphQL, and he just did some hacking on top of that, like ask as it was announced on React Europe. This is a blog post by a guy who was the really long RESTful thing I showed you earlier. So this is how their story, how they were migrating from REST to GraphQL. This is a new shock co-creator of the GraphQL. He did like an hour-long talk. This presentation was actually highly inspired by the talk. And yes, GraphQL.org, that's a documentation and specification. Reindex. And this is a podcast episode which I did with Relay team. Really interesting to listen. And shameless plug for my podcast. Yes, sample requests if I have something like that. And you got this Relay team. Yeah, the generally means this whole thing is quite. So we talked about quite a lot of different technologies in this thing, and it's supposed to be like a conversation open in a way how you think about implementing web applications nowadays. So it's like there's so many aspects you have to address, and so many aspects you sometimes address poorly or trying to not address them. And again, like yeah, so many things. But hopefully, like GraphQL allows you to think in different ways when you implement the web application, how you fetch the data, how you sort of use this data, how you present the data to your different clients. Also thinking about like generally speaking, you have quite often you have like multiple clients, and like the whole separation between backend providing you the data, or possibilities to fetch the data, and then the clients fetching the data. It's like as opposed to the backend dictating you what kind of thing you can do, instead of that it just providing you means for consuming the data in also different ways. We're also finding out interesting things, like generally UI wants to move as fast as possible because UI and UX are really hard, and delivering quality product for end users requires you iteration on UI and UX. Iteration usually requires you changing features in a way. So you need different, when you change a feature on the application, you need to fetch a different data or fetch a different way, something, or something missing, so you need to fetch something else. And GraphQL allows you to do, to iterate on UX and UI much faster. You don't need to request from backend team, especially if something else doing it somewhere else, in different country, in different time zone, and their backlog is full of is something else. So it's like, if you need this new feature, okay, see you in 6 months. So instead, they provide you, well, idea, with the possibilities of fetching data, and you decide what kind of data you want.
I love that idea, obviously, of shaping the data. That's the biggest draw for the client, you know, to shape the data from that it wants it. A couple of questions on that then, from simple in terms of the data type. Can the client say, on a stream, but truncate it at 20 characters, otherwise I'm going to fly wobbly? Or I want a floating point, number, but I want it rounded to 3 decimal places, that's hopefully what you've got. That's a simple sort of case. Then there are, I suppose, combined fields. If you had something, facile example of a backend that's sort of first name, last name, one field that you wanted to split, is there a way of applying an operation on the data before it's returned? And then finally, I suppose, security, is there a way of specifying what clients can access what bits? I love it. The client shaping the data is brilliant. For a backend, I think, excellent, I could throw the kitchen sink at my server, and it will only serve the client what it asks for. If this client is allowed the password, hash, this client isn't, or this is allowed the social security number, but that one isn't, is there a way in the React query when you're shaping the data to also, the server, take your authentication into account and decide what fields it's allowed to return? So has that been matured to a specification about how you go about doing that, finding what clients are allowed?
So regarding permissions, although there's nothing in specifications about it. But re-index, which I was showing before, they actually, I think they implemented something like that. So
there was a thing being turned back for permission.
Okay.
Oh,
there you go.
Yeah,
that's right. Yeah,
okay,
that down
to the field. Yeah, it has to be done. So those guys, it's effectively, up for the server too. And then you can implement this any way you want. So those guys actually thought about that. But they actually implement something like this. So you can, I don't know, token, something. Yeah, but effectively, yeah, you have server, you have a client, the server can decide, okay, but also you must provide this token, or I'm not talking to you. So,
yeah, is that Donald Rumsfeld something, isn't it? The known knowns or the unknown unknowns. It's one thing the server saying, I'm not even going to return to you, the idea that there even is a national short something record when you query, when you're the introspection says, what have you got? I'm not even going to tell you what the national short number. But you might say, I have got it, but it will not be included in your results unless you authenticate with that one specific user, or however you authenticate, and then I will allow just that one. So it's not fine, it's not here or there. It's the client needs a way of saying, right, and here are some authentication credentials.
Yeah, so this is not part of the specification of GraphQL itself. Mm-hmm. But again, I guess you could implement this.
Yeah. So it's at the transport level at the moment, rather than the message level. It's not attached to the envelope of the message and here are my things. You have to do it at the transport level, and the server recognise that and shape its responses.
But it's true, like, how do you deal with that? How do you deal with getting the error that there's a specific part of, because you could request data from like a whole very variety of things, but you might have just requested one little bit of forbidden data. You don't want the entire thing to fail, you just want this, like, not that forbidden fruit.
I guess it's just up for the whoever is implementing the server, GraphQL server, to decide how you implement the result of your query. So,
So this isn't going to be an uncommon case, and admin interfaces. The first React Native app was an admin interface. So presumably it's either going to be coming down the pipe from Facebook when you're implementing something, or which is going to go ask us.
Yeah.
The only thing I'd sort of draw parallels with, it's not an advance and it dropped out of favour years ago obviously, but Site Web Services had introspection with Web Service Description language, WSDL. But then when they took the authentication and security side of things, yes, you have the transport level, whether you're in the HTTP level making requests or the underlying TCP level with the packet, but they then added, message level with your message body, there's an envelope and you can put credentials in for certain things. And that's the one thing I'm seeing missing. So the authentication, yes, it's up to the server to decide what you're allowed to give, but the client has to have a way of saying, and this is who I am. And at the moment that's being pushed down, I suppose, to the transport layer, even though React.js is independent of the transport layer. But I can see a lot of scenarios where it needs to be the message level, because for certain bits of the message and not others, and that situation, you just get signed, you're not, you get the opportunity then to have a request response or not. I can see that maybe that's just somewhere where there needs to be some work as well, in terms of adding that in to the message level rather than the transport level.
Positive, yeah.
Can I see my curling soap?
How
would you do pagination?
Do you have any examples yet? Okay, I can show you. So, this is actually a really fun part of the game. So, except I need to create a few objects for that. Bear with me. Let's create some pagination.
Robert, your other question about the splitting and showing because all of the each query is sort of backed by code, arbitrary code, you can write those statements within
before you deliver the file. But when it resolves, I said, do that chamber.
You get that request, back, and then
you do it. Almost like you're shaping it twice.
Who's trying to do it?
And then you do a few logical operations to try to make it.
You try and even that
in?
Send those.
You could just get the idea.
Let's create a few of those. So let's create maybe. This is again like pumping. You can have multiple mutations. Maybe I should. Oh, I guess because I'm animals. So I must provide some names. So. Now we have like four users for creator. We're going to do like not query, and we're going to do four users. This is where you can. This is kind of partially coming from Relay actually. So you can do images, and then this is where you can provide. Thank you. pagination.
It's more about, I mean, there's that actually part of the pagination that kind of lets me like progress like the first lot. It doesn't give me a way of saying how many there are, knowing if I've got all of them, and also starting from where I left off.
Maybe not that advanced.
Is that all users thing? That's something that's been put together by the re-index thing, right? That's not part of the step.
The first, last, before and after, I believe this is actually coming from relay way of implementation of a server.
You can pick up the cursor as well, can't you?
Yeah.
And then you can say after, so the pagination, you can pick up the cursor and say, oh, there'll be more after this cursor.
Okay.
I think the cursor's empty or something, there's nothing else.
Before being cursor.
So where did you get the cursor from then?
It's just a field, is it not in the edge?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'm waving my hands quite often. I've read that somewhere.
That makes sense. So yeah, pretty much for free, you get presentation. We use this on a blog engine as well, pretty useful.
So far I've seen, the only things I've seen that aren't making REST requests are maybe the email is the sort of the SWAPI graphical repo on GitHub.
Mm-hmm.
So that's SQLite, isn't it, database. So is that making a direct request or is it making REST requests as well? Because I haven't seen any examples of GraphQL just directly querying a database if that's a question.
So again, this is like server-side implementation. The way you want to implement server-side database is completely up to you. You can use any sort of logic you normally do.
I didn't really phrase that quite right. So there's everything I've seen so far is like a REST proxy. And so do you know, are there implementations in place for specific databases yet? So
I think this is where you have to be like opinionated in a way. Like, and again, there's so many opinions what kind of database or persistent mechanism you should use, and it's always different for each application. I think this is where you would sort of cross the line of being too opinionated. So I guess all the implementations of GraphQL so far have been only for parsing the string on the server and, well, then just providing you with means, okay, now parse everything, now it's kind of up to you. So what you're going to do this. So I don't think this is going to be, there might be some example applications in the way, but this is where you're sort of crossing the line into being really opinionated.
Yeah.
And the risk. But I mean, it's not hard for me.
Well, I mean, Nick Schrock was talking about that. He was saying, oh, you know, at the first layer, you use a REST proxy because that's the way that you can implement on top of an existing structure, but later on you would be getting rid of the services and taking
and
queries direct on the database. So.
Yeah, and this is when you just put the data request again in the result. You would say, okay, instead of doing RESTful requests, let's just query the database.
Right.
The database, yes.
In a lot of ways, I can see, again, from a forward back end point of view, we use object relational mappers at the moment to deal with objects and you don't care about data, you use an RRM and stuff like that. At the same time, that RRM software, where the generate data schema, could generate your GraphQL server or schema for the server and links to the same. So you're only dealing objects, doesn't care about persistence, and you also get for free of GraphQL. Okay, it's opinionated to an extent, but not tied to underlying storage, it's opinionated based on the server side objects that you create.
There is SQL to GraphQL converter on the
It's pretty. That's like one extra step you like to objects to SQL to
it will convert to something, but it doesn't do any linking or
Do you know what re-index uses actually? Because obviously when you give re-index a schema, it must build some database in the background.
Yeah, and there was a guy who behind this.
Is it sort of Mickey Mouse? Is it for planning this rather than for default?
They are, as far as I know, they are built on top of Bluemix.
Bluemix?
Is
Those boobies.
It's like AWS from IBM. Is there usually some sort of graph database behind it, actually? But in a way, they just abstract, you know, so you don't have to. I mean, you don't have to think about that, so they basically take care of it.
It's like it's a very graphical version of sort of Dream Factory, isn't it?
Right.
It's kind of, if you're fine, and you just need a data somehow, or there's one you were talking about a lot of use for the football map.
Oh, where are the
buttons? Fine, yeah. So you just, it's just a database and you stick your stuff in it, and then you don't have to care about it.
Julian, I was thinking of, in terms of XAMN, which was, back in the day, wasn't it, XPath implementation, and to cope with two different DOM implementations, they made it so that you could query any tree-shaped structure. You just have to implement a class and like a resolve function, and there you go, XPath for any tree-shaped shape.
Yeah.
I was going to ask, Alex, what the relationship between GraphQL today and the Facebook graph data today is?
It's probably two separate things. This is like a, I mean, in a way, this is like a graph of data, in a way, you guess. But it's like there's two different blocks, I guess. Nick was saying that like the graph in the name of GraphQL doesn't mean that it's related to graph database in any way.
No, I get that.
But I suppose the question is, have Facebook implemented a GraphQL server with as a front to their graph data?
So they're like using GraphQL internally on their own data set, and B, can we use it as well on their data set?
There must be the ad app of it. That's obviously clearly something they're well database, so they must have their server.
They have one endpoint for the whole Facebook.
Okay.
Contains tens of thousands of tab definitions. And every single application of Facebook is using that endpoint. But
the GraphQL endpoint.
But it's not only, so we cannot use it. But there's only well, it's quite fascinating because they have, they still keep on, I think they serve like, I don't know, millions of requests every day. It's just massive, the whole thing. It's just, yeah.
Do you think, or have you encountered problems where the GraphQL makes it very easy to express queries that the back end can't efficiently answer? So, you know, it'd be very easy to say, I'll get this and this and this, and actually that involves a lot of work.
So you actually, I think, so right now we're effectively giving our applications lots of services around. So we're still like scratching the surface of this. And the asynchronous example of result is effectively what the first issue we encounter. So, okay, you have to request a bunch of services, probably asynchronous in non-blocking way. And also, it might be errors. This is what we came up with so far. But I think there are going to be more of that coming out and has begun. And there's a small danger as well in the way how you can construct GraphQL queries, because potentially if you do lots of nesting and stuff, you might end up in the resolve method, like resolving quite a lot, making quite a lot of requests and taking quite a lot of time. This is actually an interesting issue with the whole technology in itself. Potentially you can create a query which will look really nice, but will take an enormous amount of time to actually resolve. It's an issue that's unresolved.
I guess it won't be resolved, because a query optimizer needs to know how, a query planner needs to know how the thing is implemented.
In a way,
That's the trade-off between being agnostic and showing the data how you like, with no opinionated, here's some conventions, because then the back end can, based on those conventions, optimize itself. So, always going to be one or the other.
Exactly.
There's convenience for it, but solve the back end challenge, so make it work.
I'm intrigued as to, you said that Relay is kind of long term meant to be more of a replacement for Flux, but of course Relay is just sort of get data between the back end and the front end. it's not taking into account user interactions at all. Well, their effect on the data.
Well, it kind of does, because when you do initialize applications, they're all based on user interactions. Just at the moment, it's not optimal for local data that you don't want to communicate or receive from a server. So it's specifically, at the moment, it's specifically built for handling scenarios when the data is originated remotely and must be sent back and all this complicated stuff. But in the roadmap, as far as I remember, they have like local state handling as well. And because the way Relay works already, they implement central state structure for the whole data. And it's effective, but Flux is again one implementation of Flux is like every single state, central state of the whole application. So yeah. But yeah, right now you still need something else in addition to Relay to handle just a local state, which Flux is one option. We are actually opting for Redux, which works for us, you know, and also for server side. But then again, I think we will have to tackle the problem of like optimistic updates and stuff when we actually get there, mentioned. Hopefully, Redux will help us.
Any other questions? No? You sure?